So let's unpack a little bit what you said, Michael. You're exactly right in everything that you said, and we can sort of write down these things, I think, more generally by simply noting a few of the pluses and the minuses, the pros and the cons. So in the filtering case, one of the things that you didn't say explicitly but I think was built into what you said is a question of speed. So filtering is faster than wrapping because you don't have to worry about what the learner wants. You don't have to worry about paying the cost of what the learner is going to do. You can basically just apply any fast algorithm you might imagine that takes a look at the features and does some sort of filtering. It is, of course, as we pointed out before, an exponential problem, but you can do some kind of approximation in here, and you can make it basically arbitrarily as fast as you want it to be, which I think is what you were thinking about originally when we started the quiz. So you do get speed, and the price that you're paying for that speed is that you tend to look at the features in isolation. So what do I mean by that? Well, you may look at a feature and say, this feature is unimportant for whatever reason. But maybe that feature is important if you combine it with another feature. Say maybe we're in a kind of a parity problem again. And so some feature might look unimportant, but actually, in fact, it is important. And the only way you're going to get the kind of speed up that you need is typically by looking at features in isolation, either adding them or removing them. And of course, the reason it gets this speed is that it ignores the learning problem itself, at least the learner itself, if not the learning problem. By contrast, wrapping actually takes into account model bias. It takes into account whatever the learning bias of the learning algorithm is in order to determine what the best subfeatures are, which means it's actually worried about the problem of learning itself, which I don't know how to spell, apparently. But in the process, it's much, much slower. Because every time it tries to look at a particular subset, a candidate subset, it has to run the learning algorithm. Imagine this learning algorithm is something like neural network learning. This could take thousands and thousands of iterations. You might have to do cross-validation. There's all kinds of things you might have to do before you even get to look at the next thing and get a score. And so wrapping makes a lot more sense because it takes into account the learning problem and, more importantly, the learning bias or the inductive bias of the learning algorithm. But it's going to take a very, very long time to do it, while filtering tends to go pretty well. You buy that?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay. So let me ask you a question before we sort of move on. Can you think of any algorithms that we've looked at in the last mini course on supervised learning that basically was already doing filtering?
So it's not quite the same because that's supervised and now we're talking about unsupervised. But we did look at some algorithms that explicitly decided which features to include and which ones not. I'm thinking of decision trees maybe, and I think boosting kind of has a little bit of this depending on what the weak learner set is.
Right. That's true. I mean, the problem with boosting is that it's sort of not, it's not picking the features so much as it's picking examples. But certainly with decision trees, you're exactly right. Decision trees are in its own way a kind of filtering algorithm. So this might not be obvious, and maybe I could have been clearer about it, but you get these features, and I think you actually asked me this question, but you get these features, but you do know what the labels are if there's a supervised learner built in. If you're going to have a learner at the end of the day, it's considered cheating in the filtering case to look inside the learner, but it's not considered cheating to understand what the labels are. So you can take advantage of the actual labels of your examples in order to do your filtering. So, in fact, if you take the main part of decision trees, which is information gain, that's actually a way of doing filtering on the features. So the criterion is information gain. Find me the features that provide you with the most information given the class label, and that gets exactly the subset.
Cool. Now, I don't quite see how to iterate that, though. So I can see how you can get the first feature that way. Then are we talking after that we're going to select features that add information above and beyond what we've already gotten out of the other features we've selected?
Sure. So, in fact, imagine that my search algorithm here is actually decision trees. So I take a bunch of features. I take a bunch of labeled data. I run my decision tree algorithm. It picks a subset of the features. Maybe I do pruning, crossvalid, whatever. It's just an arbitrary search algorithm. I just drew a box here. And then what I do is I take all the features that were used by the decision tree algorithm, and I pass that to my learner. Hmm. Now, if the learner is a decision tree learner, I'd presumably get back the same decision tree. But maybe that's a way of picking a subset of features that are useful for example, a neural network or a perceptron or KNN.
In which case, I don't quite see how to do the filtering.
Well, you run a decision tree algorithm here.
Oh.
That gives you the set of features that the decision tree thinks is important. And you return that set of features, basically the entire, not the tree, but you flatten the tree and then just turn that into a set of features. So imagine, for example, that we actually put inside this box a decision tree learner. that uses the set of data as input with all of its features and all of the labels that it knows about. It builds a decision tree, which gives you typically a subset, well, in fact, by definition, gives you a subset of all the features. And then the features that come out of the decision tree are passed on to another learner, like, for example, a perceptron or a neural network or even something like KNN.
It always comes back to KNN.
Everything comes back to KNN.
So let me make sure I understand. So we run a decision tree learner, but we don't want to use what it actually determined. Instead, we say, let's just look at all the things that got split on, and the union of all of those now become features to hand off to some other learning algorithm.
Right.
But why would we want to do that if we already trained up the decision tree?
Because we're worried that the decision tree doesn't do as good a job as you would like on noisy data, for example. Or you're just going to run the decision tree to some depth. Or even what you want to do is you're going to run the decision tree until it actually overfits. And now you know all the features that you could use, and you pass that on to some other learner, which has a different bias. So basically you use the inductive bias of the decision tree to choose features, but then you use the inductive bias of your other learner in order to do learning. Right, and if you think about the big difference between, for example, KNN and decision trees, we know that KNN suffers from the curse of dimensionality because it doesn't know which features are important. But decision trees are very good at figuring out which features are important, at least for predicting the label. And so you could ask your decision tree to give some hint to KNN, which has other nice things going for it, which features it should actually pay attention to.
Cool.
All right, so there you go.